This is Channel A, the City University of New York.
Welcome to Cinema Then, Cinema Now, the film series with lively discussion. I'm your host, Jerry Carlson, and I teach cinema studies at the College of Staten Island. Today, we'll be seeing Sergei Eisenstein's Alexander Nevsky. Produced in 1938, this film is a nationalistic epic of visual magnificence that includes a score by Sergei Prokofiev. Eisenstein himself called it a fugue on the theme of patriotism. In fact, this film raises a host of topics about the relationship between art and politics, between image and sound, and between history and the uses of cinema. We'll be returning to these topics after our screening. Tonight, our guests are going to be Professor Jay Leyda of New York University and Professor Virginia Brooks of Brooklyn College. Enjoy Alexander Nevsky. Talking and welcome back to Cinema Then, Cinema Now. I hope you enjoyed Alexander Nevsky. We have with us tonight two guests. I'd like to introduce them to you right now. We have first Professor Jay Leyda of New York University. Professor Leyda is the author of, among many scholarly works, two that pertain especially to us tonight. First of all, Kino, a history of the Russian and Soviet cinema from its origins to the present. And second of all, Eisenstein at Work, a book that chronicles the working methods of Sergei Eisenstein. In addition to being a scholar and a teacher and an author, Professor Leyda has the distinction of having studied with and then worked with Sergei Eisenstein. I'm sure he'll be willing to share a great deal of that with us tonight. My second guest tonight is Professor Virginia Brooks of Brooklyn College. At Brooklyn College, she's in the film department, where she heads the production program. In addition to her teaching duties in production, Virginia has special interest in how dance is filmed. In addition to that, and one of the reasons we have her with us tonight, she has a specialty in Soviet and Eastern European cinema and has taught several courses on that for us at Brooklyn College. I thought we might start this evening, Jay, by talking about, first of all, how you ended up in the Soviet Union, and since second of all, from there, what this film meant to Eisenstein himself. I mean, how did he get involved in this film project?
Can we take those two questions apart?
Sure. You're doing it
they don't join very well.
Okay, then start with the first.
There was nothing accidental about my going to the Moscow Institute.
Okay.
It was all deliberate, very deliberately planned. I even made a film in order to get in.
Okay. Were you inspired to go there by seeing an Eisenstein film?
Oh, probably. And it was the only film school in the world then.
Okay.
And when I heard that Eisenstein was teaching the director's course, nothing could chain me down.
Okay, and so you got from where?
Oh, I used people, I pulled strings, just everything. And made a film of my own, which I'm not sorry I made. Yeah. But the main motive for it was to get me in, so it accomplished its purpose.
Yeah, okay. And then you saw
the people who looked at it there all had different reasons for liking it. You could detect that because they all assumed that it was an imitation of their methods.
Okay.
So Veritov liked it for one reason, Eisenstein liked it for another reason, and so on.
Okay, flattery is the best way to get into...
I didn't say a word.
Okay. Well, so you ended up not only studying with Eisenstein, but working with him as well.
Yes. He hadn't made a film for a long time, and people were complaining bitterly about that. So finally he was driven to make a film and make it in a hurry, too. But he was, I think, the most efficient film director in the Soviet Union. He could always surprise the film factory that he was working in by turning in a film. Nevsky, for example, was turned in 4 months before its deadline.
4 months before its deadline, but it looks like a picture with extraordinary potential production problems. I mean, look. I mean,
all the problems in each film were solved in advance, and glued in advance to the thing that he wanted to be challenged within that film, within that subject. No film of his looks like any other film of his.
Okay, but at the same time, we all know we're watching an Eisenstein film. I mean, there's a certain mark to him.
Well, I wonder sometimes whether you would.
okay.
Because there are lots of imitation Eisenstein films.
True enough, but I think there's still a sense that there's a sense of movement about some of the things he does, the way he stages things that are pretty distinct. And I might want to ask Virginia about.
If I could watch him taking that film, I could be sure, but if it were just on the screen.
Okay. Well, I just want to ask Virginia for a second about that sense of how distinctive it is when you see people move in Eisenstein. I mean, am I right or am I wrong or, you know, what?
Well, the distinctive characteristic of this and the films before are that there is no camera movement as such, that the main movement that you see is movement that has been choreographed, in fact, by the subjects. And very often, not even that. They're stationary tableaus between which the cuts are made. So that the sense of depth that you get is realized in a different way in terms of the different planes that he has people stationed at.
This distinction between the several films was part of his trouble, because in his early films, they always wanted, make another Potemkin, make another Potemkin.
Okay.
Well, that wasn't his plan for his life and career.
So he just...
He had lots of things he wanted to work with and experiment with.
Okay. Now, how did this particular film that we've just seen come about? I mean, how did he get involved in this project itself?
He was given two figures familiar to the public in the Soviet Union, either Alexander Nevsky, who was a saint, or Ivan Susanin, who was the hero in Glinka's opera. And he said, there's no question about it. I want to take Nevsky because we know nothing about him.
Okay, but for a Russian audience, when this film was produced and came out, would this be the equivalent, of knowing a legendary character like American children knew Davy Crockett as a great frontiersman or something of that sort?
They might have known something about Ivan Susanin, but as I said, there was nothing known about Alexander Nevsky except his sainthood.
Okay, so essentially,
and his essential patriotism. Mm-hmm. And so this was bound to be a patriotic film.
Okay.
But the figure in it was rather amorphous at certain points.
So he was given a blank slate in that way to fill it in the ways...
Yes, he gave himself the blank slate.
Oh, okay. Okay. That's a very interesting sort of thing to have. What was the political situation in the Soviet Union at that time? I mean, were there a lot of obviously it's a state-run film industry, but what kind of problems would he have run into?
Well, I mean, there was a specific request from the government that he make this film at this time.
And he had lots of other problems, too. For one thing, this film was made in 1938.
Okay.
He had been making films since 1925, but this was his first completed and distributed, shown publicly, sound film.
Okay.
In between, there were plenty of projects, but they were all rejected for one reason or another. So actually, a history of his projects belongs with a history of his films.
Okay, so...
And they were always sound, of course. But this was the first time the sound became public sound.
Okay. He had made statements along with Pudovkin, the other director, and Alexandrov, about what the proper uses of sound would be.
Well, you'll find that this film contradicts them completely. Contradicts that manifesto, anyway, on sound.
Let's stop for a second, and just since I don't think a lot of our viewers know that manifesto.
Well, let me describe it.
Okay.
One of its main aims was to persuade people to regard the image and the track as not necessarily synchronized.
Okay.
while one of the problems in Nevsky was to synchronize everything precisely.
Okay. So one of the things, at least let's go back to the manifesto for a second.
Or rather, to make it a little more precise, to synchronize its emotions with its music.
Okay.
And its sound.
Right. But one of the things that they had feared initially was that the sound film was going to turn into canned theater. That is, that the distinctive cinematic
quality. And we know that did happen.
Yes, and that's why Hollywood.
It happened in the Soviet Union, too.
Partly because the new cameras and the restrictions on them were so much larger, and they didn't have whatever mobility they had finally achieved in the silent films toward the end. They couldn't. Everything was much heavier,
yeah,
and so it was harder to move around. But wouldn't you say that there was a structure to this in terms of the divisions between the sort of singing sections as opposed to the spoken word? In other words, there are divisions which divided in terms of the romantic song, the patriotic song, and they're sort of led in little...
Well, Prokofiev knew his job very well.
Exactly. Well, I mean, there are references to other Prokofiev pieces, as there are in almost every Prokofiev piece, but they come in sort of almost as if they're lead-ins to a particular section, that there's this kind of music that's going to tell you that they're going to now march off to war. And then there's this kind of...
No, the oratorio that it was turned into afterwards, just the music, shows that there was an oratorio base.
Design.
Not to mention an opera base also.
Sure. Okay. Now, how did...
Because opera and oratorio both wanted emotions to coincide with the music.
Right.
Okay. How did Prokofiev get involved in this? Did Eisenstein and Prokofiev know one another before this and want to collaborate, or was this one of those moments in which they said, well, we've got a great composer and we've got a great director, let's throw them together and see what comes out of that?
Yes, they were thrown together.
Okay. Well, it turned out to be one of the happiest throwings together in the history of cinema. But an interesting...
And two more films after Nevsky were also scored by Prokofiev, but they were not completed.
Oh, okay. Which were those, Jay?
Fergana Canal was to be another big slabs of history, which started with the Mexican film, slabs of history that contrasted as well as melted into each other.
Okay.
Then Ivan Grozny, Ivan the Terrible, of which we know only the first part as being genuinely his. The second part is mangled, and the third part was destroyed.
Okay, so this is
but
the
those
one.
Those were to be, those were to have their own styles too.
Okay. Now, the interesting thing about the fact that we're using the word operatic is that I think in the 20th century, one of the ways in which storytelling film has developed is it's for a lot of people, it's been in opposition to opera, because in the 20th century, opera is perceived by many people as highbrow culture. Whatever its origins may be in the 19th century, it's perceived by a wide popular audience as something, you know, to be avoided. Gee, I'd much rather go to the movies than have to go sit through an opera or some way. I've heard that phrase many a time from many a person. But for Eisenstein, I think you were saying this just before the show, Jay, saying a film was operatic was not any sense of slur on it.
Not for him.
Well, okay.
But it was a word that meant opprobrium of some sort among critics.
Yeah.
It wasn't pure film.
Okay. And of
course, there is this sense of tableaus which occur in many cases in this film.
And even more in Ivan the Terrible.
Exactly. Where they're set up with these incredible compositions which are beautiful to behold, but they're also very static for a period of time, which is not the way we think of films as going, unless you take into account the movement that results from cutting between these static shots, which is considerable.
Well, by that time, he had decided that montage as an element doesn't necessarily force you to have montage between the pieces, but even within each piece.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And not just in the case of movement either, but sometimes two static things follow each other, almost like a kaleidoscope.
Well, you have something
and
coming,
that provides the montage.
And you have something coming in the negative space of the previous shot, so that
That's
your
right.
eye is drawn to a particular section of the frame by the cut.
So that is not a deviation from his montage principles at all.
It's only an expansion of it into other into other realms.
Well, a burrowing into it, really.
Yeah, okay. Okay, but the film is really magnificent for its rhythms, I mean, because we do have that sense of tableau, the sense of the depth of field and the definition of things, one plane after another, and then, of course, we come to the climactic battle on the ice, in which, even though, I think you were saying, isn't there just one camera movement that you were finding in the battle? The ice itself?
It's afterwards. It's after the battles are completely over. And in fact, all the movement in the battle has been provided by the movement of the subjects. But the if you'd like to talk about the battle first, I'll talk about the aftermath afterwards.
Okay. Well, let's talk about the battle. I mean, first of all, I think some of our audience might be interested to know this is not only a very famous sequence in film history, but one that's been extraordinarily influential. So that Henry IV, the film made by Lawrence Fifth. English history was so long ago.
And so was Shakespeare.
He's closer. But the Henry V, excuse me, that Laurence Olivier made during World War II.
I don't think he would possibly have made that kind of film without Nevsky.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Do you think we can push it as far forward?
And then people began to imitate Henry V.
Exactly.
Do you think we can push it as far forward as something like Apocalypse Now? And there's of course, in that film is a very famous helicopter.
You wouldn't dare touch it.
Okay. Well, we won't touch it. Let's just go back.
With the Ride of the Valkyries for the helicopters.
But Eisenstein had just staged a Wagner opera. He staged one right after making this film,
soon after, yes.
Yes. And one of the things you were talking about in montage is that there is this movement in Eisenstein's thinking from a notion of montage as something that develops reflex in an audience, that generates reflex, to this movement towards synesthesia, where he can suggest one sense through using another's in another sense. And that comes from
Wagner. It's true. He was always very aware that all the senses have to be appealed to in some way.
Yeah. Well, let's go back to the battle on the ice, Virginia.
In July.
In July. Well, I think it should be pointed out, why don't you talk about that just for a moment, just the production fact that's, I think, interesting.
Well, I think that's
an
really...
An efficiency fact.
Yes,
efficiency
exactly. I was going to say, I'm sure that Professor Leyda has a better conception of what was going on there, since, but the whole production problems of doing it in the middle of the summer in the extraordinary heat and having to provide artificial snow and all of that sort of thing.
I have an idea. I wouldn't want to have one of those Teutonic helmets on in the midst of July in the outskirts of Moscow.
I'm sure they didn't appreciate it either.
Mm-hmm. Yes, but Eisenstein certainly got what he wanted.
They gave him what he wanted.
Yes, and we have that. Well, back to what makes that sequence so distinctive and so influential, as we've tried to chronicle.
Well, it's full of so many different techniques to provide that sense of incredible action with a large number of people without letting you completely lose track of who's fighting whom, where the battle is going on. I mean, they have distinctive costumes so that you can keep track of them that way, but it's an extraordinary melee, and it's being done in such a way that you have a sense of, aside from the fact that you're being told about the wedge and the various tactical
methods.
Oh, you
do know who is who, which is not always true of battle.
Exactly. Right. So it's quite amazing from that standpoint, for me at least. I'm always interested when I can keep track of the combatants and who's doing what.
Let me stop just for a second. It is true that Eisenstein controlled all aspects of production. I mean, certainly he had marvelously gifted crew.
He was a wonderful producer.
Okay. So,
and at one time, they made some use of him as a producer. They put him in charge of the Mosfilm studio.
Okay.
And the films that were turned out there by normally qualified people are usually their best films.
Now, for example, with regard to this whole issue of the costumes, and nobody forgets the Teutonic Knights. I mean, you see one or two images of them, and whatever else you may think of the film, you'll never forget them. Now, he did the costume sketches himself for all of these.
And the helmets.
The claw and the hand.
The claw and the hand. Well, I think most of the people who are watching this, for one reason or another, have probably seen Star Wars, and they might be interested to know where a lot of this stuff came from. This is not to demean George Lucas, who's very smart and knows who he knows the people he's borrowing from
film. I'm a proponent of plagiarism.
Yes.
I think that without plagiarism, the film would not have speeded up so wonderfully in its history.
Well, at least shoulders to stand on.
Well,
it's
yes.
not actual plagiarism.
And
I don't mind imitation either.
Was it Faulkner who also said that mediocre artists borrow, great artists steal mercilessly? So let's get back to the battle. We talked about the costumes and that sense, but there's an incredible sense of movement there. We don't have a moving camera. I mean, how does that work?
You don't really need it. I mean, consider the number of people who are moving on the screen, and also in the close-ups, the amount of movement. If you notice, there's a lot of very repetitious movement in those close-ups. You'll get somebody hacking somebody apart, and they do it with a vengeance for quite a period of time. Some of those shots are very long. But there's also things you can see going on behind that close person doing the thing, which gives you a sense of...
And just imagine that everything was worked out on paper, too.
Yeah, so he knew exactly what he was looking for when he went to each...
So in that way, I mean, we talk about similarities among some directors. There's a very popular story about anyone who saw Hitchcock on a set who looked profoundly bored simply for the reason that the film, in one sense, for him had already been made because he had planned every detail,
every shot. I know this is digressing, but have you ever seen a Hitchcock sketch for a scene? I haven't.
Oh. I'm trying to think if I've seen a picture of a storyboard.
A very good friend of mine was his assistant for some time, and he had never seen any of the sketches either.
So perhaps lurking away somewhere are the sketches.
No, he put it together in his mind. It didn't have to be on paper, perhaps.
Okay, but it's, in that sense, it's utterly pre-planned. I mean, there's no...
But Eisenstein was taking no chances. He put it on paper because in some sequences, he wanted the assistant director to be working on that sequence while he was working on another sequence. Mm-hmm. So he would just hand him his whole concept and plan for the sequence.
Okay.
In this case, it was Dmitry Vasilyev,
okay.
who was also a very efficient assistant director who had turned in very commendable jobs of efficiency. So they got along very well.
Okay. Well, now we were going to go back to after the ice sequence. And the fact that we get all of this motion with no moving camera during the ice sequence, and then we get the moving camera when, is it?
Well, there's a period in which they're showing you all of the bodies strewn around, and there's a cut to a raven on a body, and
right.
then there's a cut to the two romantic heroes, I guess you might want to call them.
Such as they are.
Rivals and heroes. And they're talking about the fact that they're both still alive, and then the women are seen coming, actually they've already been cut to before that, coming across the horizon in a very deep shot from the horizon forward, carrying torches and looking
and
over
built
the
for a mezzo-soprano.
Right. And as their singing women approach, they look very concentratedly into the camera and say, listen to who's singing and who's coming toward us. At which point, there is the one camera move in the film, in which the camera tracks backward over this scene, but they're not in the shot, which is very interesting to me, because normally if you'd been given that kind of setup for a point of view shot, you'd expect to, or a subjective shot or something, you'd expect to at least see the people, or if it were going to be a, backtrack, if you were going to say it was a subjective shot, the shot would go away from them as you watched what they were looking at. Instead, it's going the opposite way, and then the next cut is to the woman that they're both in love with, Olga.
So
that was very interesting to me that was
okay, so
designed that way, and I don't know why, but it was very...
Eisenstein is one of those directors so seminal to the development of the medium that we can say two things about him. He not only concocts a whole set of rules or a whole set of ways of shooting mm-hmm. that people would imitate till today, I mean certainly mm-hmm. They're imitated whether he would like it or not on 30-second advertisements all mm-hmm. the time. Selling the revolution and selling soap can be used, same methods can be used. But in addition to that, he's somebody who set up rules and then knew exactly when to break his own rules.
Broke his own rules,
sure.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And that's what is so extraordinarily interesting and really exciting about looking at what he's done, because you get to see him stating one thing and then trying something else, which is...
Yeah. Now, we've been talking thus far about so many of the visual aspects and some of the oral aspects of the film. I'd like to talk a little bit about something that may make this film a little not so palatable to a lot of people today, and that is the story. The story seems... Many people, when they're talking about a great film, the first thing...
It's very simple.
Yeah.
Very slight story.
It's a very, very slight story. And so the critical complaint that would come from most people is, well, what I expect from a great narrative film, a film.
But it has a major cultural clash and a physical clash, too.
Okay.
And that was enough. Didn't have to have a story.
Well, let's make sure we give that background on what that clash was. I mean, this film was produced in 1938, and of course, it's a film, as you were saying earlier, that portrays the past, so the people can understand
the present.
The present, yeah, and that's a mode of film I think quite familiar to those of us who've seen a lot of Eastern European
no,
cinema.
No, he gave it a name too. He, in writing to Ivor Montague, he said, "We're making a big anti-fascist machine."
Machine.
Well, he had that sense of this monolithic force moving forward in many of the shots.
And all the things being carefully set into place and structured.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, of course, one of the things, just to talk about the visuals of the film in relation to that idea, is that as a number of critics have pointed out, everything having to do with Teutonic Knights is symmetrical, it's highly ordered. We think of the scene in which they have their all of their shields down and they're repelling, at least initially repelling the Russians. Whereas all those compositions with the Russians, though they have extraordinary beauty, they have magnificence, they're frequently asymmetrical. We have a notion that the Russians are, if not disorganized, they're reticent about being as machine-like themselves or as orderly in exactly the way as the Teutonic Knights are orderly.
And he throws in a little decadence with the black monk.
Oh, yes, yes, yes. Well,
just to cover all the possibilities.
Well, I think a word we haven't used yet, but it was certainly apt to this kind of film, is it's allegorical. I mean, it comes out of a tradition of allegorical narrative. Where
but not labeled that.
So what we might call it is an open allegory, where the audience, when seeing it, are...
Well, an allegory built out of fragments of reality.
Hmm. Okay.
Perhaps.
Okay, that's good. Now, this film, of course, opens when in Russia?
13th century?
Yeah, 1240-something.
Okay, 1240 is when it's set. And as we were saying earlier...
These are crusaders. And on their way to Palestine, they were scooping up countries, too.
Okay.
And Russia was just another country for them to scoop up.
Okay. And do we really even know that much about that period? I mean...
Very little. Very little.
Yeah, yeah. So... the notion that everyone had those particular haircuts or whatever was just something that's taken from icons or whatever.
Maybe.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, that sort of thing.
He knew how to use research materials, so he could easily have manipulated them in any way he wanted.
Yeah.
His purpose through.
Yeah. How was the film received in the Soviet Union itself?
Oh, as a great patriotic film.
Okay.
Which it is, if you can forget all the... terms about like operatic.
Okay, but it's officially received that way. Was it received popularly with you know, enthusiasm?
Well, the medals that he'd been waiting for all of his career, he got.
Okay.
Through this film, and it opened film production for him again. But one big enemy and several small enemies had to leave the film administration before it was possible to do that.
Okay, and so this paved the way for the films that would come afterwards. Or did he get in trouble again? Is he the kind of guy
trouble wasn't finished.
Okay.
The film that was to follow Alexander Nevsky didn't get made, but Ivan the Terrible did get made later.
Okay. This was actually
problems.
This was actually a great call to patriotism, which was ultimately then shelved soon as the
when
Saints Soviet
could
German
easily be wearing armor and so mm-hmm. on.
Okay, and when the Nazi-Soviet non-aggression pact was signed, this gets shelved, and then after the invasion of the Soviet Union by the Nazis,
it comes out again.
It was one of the first films to after that June invasion.
Yeah, I bet it was one of the first films they had. And they were very, very glad they had that film. Well, at this point, I'm going to have to say I'm very, very glad we had this film here this evening. That's about all we have time for today. What I'd like to tell the people at home is if you'd like more information about this series or about cinema studies, undergraduate or graduate, Please write Cinema Then, Cinema Now, the College of Staten Island, New York, 10301. Let me repeat that for you again. That address is Cinema Then, Cinema Now, the College of Staten Island, New York, 10301. Thank you both for being here this evening. It's been a pleasure, and I hope that our discussion here leads all of you to discussion and thought that you enjoy.
About all the things we didn't talk about.
All the things we didn't talk about.
That's right. We'll be right back.